Hello friends, welcome once again to my videos on the political science of the NCERT textbook for class 9th. In the previous videos, I discussed with you summary and questions and answers of the first chapter of this book, that is Democracy in the Contemporary World. In that chapter, with the help of cases of a few countries, we acquired a general idea about democracy. We tried to get a sense in that chapter that a democratic government is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Now in this chapter, and the title of this chapter is What is Democracy? Why democracy? As you can see it on your screen also. So in this video, we will read the summary of this chapter and we will go ahead of the general idea that we acquired in the previous chapter about democracy, and we will read some more aspects of democracy in this particular chapter. So friends, let's see what all we are going to read in this chapter, and we will see this with the help of the objectives of this chapter. So first have a look at what are the different objectives of this chapter. So friends, first of all, we will study what is democracy. We'll read it by defining democracy. So first of all, we will have a definition of democracy. Then we will see what are the various features of democracy and what distinguishes a democratic government from a non-democratic government. We will also take an overview of the broader meaning of democracy towards the end of this chapter. So let's start with the definition of democracy. So how can we define democracy? Now, as you can see here, democracy is a form of government in which the rulers are elected by the people. So this is a small definition of democracy. Now friends, this definition tells us that how a democratic government is different from a non-democratic government. What are the difference between these two types of governments? Now in a democratic government, the elected representatives of the people rule on behalf of the people. But in a non-democratic government, ruler may be a monarch, it may be a military dictator, or even a political party can rule the country. So these are the differences between the democratic and non-democratic governments. Still, is it enough for us to say that if the rulers are elected by people, then the government is a democratic one? Is it not possible that even a government run by the elected rulers is just pretending to be democratic? So let's do a kind of reality check. And to check it, we need to analyze each and every word that has been given in the definition of democracy that we have just read. So what we are going to do, that we will analyze this definition word by word, and with the examples of a few democratic countries as they call themselves, we will examine if these countries are democracy in true sense or not. So let's start our analysis, and we will first study the first keyword of the definition. So the first keyword of the definition is that elected rulers have power to take decisions. Now, what does it mean? It means that who should rule the country and who must take major decisions for the country. Now, let's analyze this with the example of Pakistan and see whether the elected representatives of the people are really ruling the country, or they are taking major decisions on behalf of the people, or someone else is doing so. So let's see the example of Pakistan. Now, what happened in Pakistan? That General Pervez Musharraf led a military coup in October 1999. He overthrew a democratically elected government and he declared himself as the chief executive of the country. Later on, he changed his designation to the president. In 2002, he held a referendum, and this referendum granted him a 5-year extension to the office. However, it was alleged that this referendum was based on malpractices and fraud. Then in August 2002, Musharraf issued a legal framework order that amended the constitution of Pakistan. This order empowered the president to dismiss the national or provincial assemblies. Not only this, the work of the civilian cabinet, which was an elected body by the people, was also to be supervised by a National Security Council, which was dominated by the military officers. Now, after this, elections were held in Pakistan for the national and state assemblies. This way, Pakistan had elections and some powers were given to the elected representatives. But the real powers rested with the military officers and Musharraf himself. Now, can we say that democracy prevailed in Pakistan in true sense? Because representatives elected by the people were not the real rulers. They could not take the final decisions. Who were taking the decisions? Decisions were taken by Musharraf and the military officers, and none of them was elected by the people. Friends, this is not the case with only Pakistan. This is the case with many other countries in the world, that the elected leaders cannot take major decisions. The major decisions are taken by someone else. So this gives us the first feature of democracy. And the first feature of democracy is that in a democracy, the final decision-making power must be with those elected by the people. So this way, with the help of first keyword from the definition of democracy, we have drawn the first feature of democracy. Now we move on to the second keyword of our definition. This second keyword is free and fair elections. Now, for elections to be free and fair, some conditions must be fulfilled. What are these conditions? So let's see the conditions which are there for free and fair elections, whether these conditions are being fulfilled in our examples or not. So here we have two examples, and our first example is China. Now let's see what happened in China. So in China, elections are held every 5 years for country's parliament, which is called as National People's Congress. The National People's Congress has the authority to appoint the president of the country. It has around 3,000 members who are elected from all over the country. Some members are elected by the army also. However, for contesting the elections, a candidate requires approval of the Chinese Communist Party. And only the members of the Chinese Communist Party or its allies parties could contest the elections which were held in the year 2002-2003. The interesting thing is that the government is always formed by the Chinese Communist Party. Okay, so this was example of China. Now let's move on to the second example. And second example is of Mexico. So in Mexico, since its independence in 1930, elections were held every 6 years to elect the president. The country has never been under a military or a dictator's rule. This is very important to note. There has always been an elected government, but till 2000, from 1930 to 2000, for 70 years, every election was won by a party called PRI, that is Institutional Revolutionary Party. Opposition parties contested the elections, but they could never win any of the elections. And it is widely assumed that the PRI used dirty tricks to win the elections. Now, what dirty tricks they played? First of all the government servants were forced to attend its party meetings. Then, teachers of the government schools forced the parents to vote for the PRI. Media ignored opposition parties' activities and only criticized them. Often, polling booths were shifted from one place to the other to make it difficult for people to cast their votes. And the PRI spent huge sum of money for its election campaigns. Now friends, keeping above in mind, these elections cannot be considered as people electing their rulers. Why? Because in China, elections do not offer people any real choice. They have to choose the ruling party and the candidates who are approved by it only. This cannot be a true choice. Then in Mexico, people seem to have some choice, but in practice, they had no choice. Candidates of the ruling party could not be defeated. So these are not fair elections. And friends, this gives us the second feature of democracy. And the second feature of democracy is that elections must offer real choice between political alternatives, and those in power have a fair chance to lose. So this way, from the second keyword of the definition, we derived the second feature of democracy. Now we move on to the third keyword of the definition of democracy, and this third keyword is that equal voting rights to all the citizens. Now friends, in democracy, the fundamental principle of political equality must be followed. However, the instances that we are going to read right now will see that equal political rights are not provided to all the citizens. So what are our examples? Our first example is Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, women do not have right to vote. Second example is of Estonia, where citizenship rules are such that people belonging to the Russian minority find it difficult to get the right to vote. And thirdly, in Fiji, the vote of an indigenous Fijian has more value than that of an Indian physician. So in these cases, equal voting rights to all adult citizens are not available. And this gives us the third feature of democracy. And the third feature of democracy is that each adult citizen must have one vote and each vote must have one value. So this is the third feature of democracy. Now we move on to the fourth keyword of the definition of democracy. And this fourth keyword is about the form of government, that what should be the form of government. Now in a democratic government, a democratic government must give respect to some basic rights of the citizens. Moreover, the rulers must not be free to do whatever they want to do. Now let's see if these conditions are satisfied in our example or not. So our next example to test this is Zimbabwe. What happened in Zimbabwe? Zimbabwe got independence from the minority rule in 1980. Since then, ZANU-PF party is ruling the country. Its leader, Robert Mugabe, ruled as the president since independence. Elections were held regularly, but every time ZANU-PF was the winner. For winning the elections, President Mugabe used unfair practices. Now what he did? First of all, the constitution of the country has been changed many times to make the president more powerful and less accountable. Then the workers of the opposition parties are harassed. Public protests and demonstrations against the government are declared illegal. Media is controlled by the government. And the government ignored the court rulings against it, and it pressurized the judges to give their decisions in favor of the government. Now, what the example of Zimbabwe describes, what does it show? So the example of Zimbabwe shows that in a democracy, the popular approval of the rulers is necessary, but it's not sufficient. Why? Because popular governments can be undemocratic and leaders can be autocratic. A true assessment of democracy is possible only through the whole electoral process, both before and after the elections. Now, what should be the democratic process before the elections? So, before the elections, there should be enough space for normal political activity, including political opposition. Then, certain basic rights should also be provided to the citizens, including freedom to choose their rulers. These rights must be protected by an independent judiciary. And what should happen after the elections? After the elections, the government cannot do whatever it wishes to do. It has to allow certain rules and procedures in discharging its functions. This way, this discussion gives us the fourth feature of democracy, and the fourth feature of democracy is that a democratic government should work within the limits set by the constitutional laws and citizens' rights. Now friends, after this discussion, a question arises that whether democracy is the best form of government. Now, there are various kinds of views about it. Some views say that the democracy is not the best form of government, they are against the democratic setup, whereas some views are in favor of democracy. So let's see these views one by one, and we will first see what are the views or what are the arguments which are against the democracy. So the first argument against democracy is that leaders are regularly changed in democracy, so there is no political stability. Second argument against democracy says that democracy involves political competition and power play, so there is no scope for morality. Third argument says that consultation with so many people leads to delay in decision making, therefore democracy is not good. Fourth argument says that elected leaders are unaware of people's interests, so sometimes they take bad decisions. Fifth argument says that as democracy is based on electoral competition, so it leads to corruption. And the sixth view says that ordinary people cannot differentiate between good and bad, so they should not decide anything. So friends, these arguments show that democracy may not be the real form of or the ideal form of government. But in reality, it is certainly better than any other form from which we can make a choice. And therefore, a number of arguments are given in favor of democracy. So let's see one by one what are the arguments which are given in favor of democracy. Now the first argument in favor of democracy says that it is a more responsive form of government. Now why it is said? It is said that democracy is better at responding to people's need than any other form of government. For this, example of China is given. Now what happened? That from 1958 to 1961, China suffered worst famine in the history of mankind. Nearly 3 crore people died due to this famine. Now supporters of the democracy argue that had China been a democratic country and had multiple party elections, then opposition parties and a free media would have criticized the government and such a large number of deaths would not have taken place. On the contrary, India's economic conditions is almost same as China's. But India has never faced famine of such scale. Why? Because subsequent Indian governments responded to the food scarcity more proactively. Why they did this? They did this because of a democratic government, a strong opposition, and a free media. Therefore, the governments could not ignore its responsibility. So therefore, it is said that democratic government is a more responsive form of government. Now, the second argument in favor of democracy is that there is better decision making in a democratic setup. Why it is said? Because a democratic decision involves many people, and therefore the chances of making mistakes are minimized. Then the third argument in favor of democracy says that in a democracy, differences and conflicts are minimized. Why it is so? Because in democracy, no one is permanent winner or no one is permanent loser. So everyone has to live in peace and harmony with others, and therefore differences and conflicts are minimized. Next argument for democracy is that there is dignity of citizens. Why dignity of citizens is maintained? Because democracy is based on the principle of equality. In a democracy, people are not subjects of a ruler, but they are the rulers themselves. Therefore, their dignity is better maintained in a democratic country. And then it is said that the democracy corrects its own mistakes. Now, why it is said? It is said that democracy has an inbuilt mechanism of correcting mistakes. If the rulers make any mistake, they have to change their decisions, or else the people will change the rulers themselves. But this is not possible in a non-democratic form of government. So we can say that although democracy cannot give solutions to all the problems, but it is certainly the best alternative which is available to us. Now friends, so far in this chapter, we have studied the meaning of democracy in a limited sense. We studied democracy as a form of government where all people do not rule, but a majority takes decision on behalf of all the people. So, taking decisions with consultation is the main feature of democracy. And this feature distinguishes democracy from all other governments. However, operation of democracy is not limited to the government. Rather, it is a way of life. Democracy not only includes government, but it includes many organizations. It includes the family also. Because in a family also, the decisions can be taken in a democratic manner. Every member of the family can be involved in decision-making process. So, therefore, we can say that democracy is not just related to the government, it is a way of life. And therefore, democracy can be applied to many spheres of life. It's a very big phenomenon. So friends, this brings us to an end of the summary of this chapter. Now in this chapter, I discussed with you, first of all, the definition of democracy, and with the help of this definition, we derived the features of democracy. We also discussed the different arguments which are given in favor of democracy and arguments which are given against the democracy. And then ultimately, we had a broader meaning of democracy. If you find this video useful for yourself, please like, share and subscribe. Keep watching, keep learning. Thank you. Have a nice time.